you see what's happening with China. We have no choice. This should have been done many years ago. We have no choice.
It's the most predatory economic government that operates against the rest of the world today.
We want to have a constructive relationship with the government of China. In order to do that, we need to repair, make some progress on some issues related to trade.
We advise the U.S. to remain rational and stop such wars to harm itself and others. This is the only viable way out.
Well, the threat of $200 billion of additional tariffs against China sent the markets reeling, not only here, but around the world, especially in Asia. You see the Dow there dropping 400 points in intraday trading, down 270 at the end. But it did make things rocky, and there were a lot of people here on Capitol Hill weighing in on all sides. We're back with the panel. Jonah, what about this strategy, and can the president and the administration force China to buckle on this?
I'm pretty skeptical. I mean, China has a long history of you know, China has a much bigger nationalism problem than almost anything else, and the idea of investing their national pride and being seen as losing face to the West or to the Americans, I think, is a real problem politically. But also, you know, it's worth pointing out that you know, the Dow is down, is now negative for the year. The Dow used to be the administration's favorite talking point about the indicator of how well things are going. They now point to better ones like unemployment and whatnot. But these things, trade wars are not easy to win, they're very hard to end. And right now, steel prices in the United States are already up 40%. We have a lot more people who are employed by firms that use steel than make them. And this could go south very quickly, and it makes me very nervous.
The trade representative Lighthizer is running point on this, but Peter Navarro, senior advisor to the president on this. Take a listen.
What we need for the American people is an enforceable, accountable, systematic change, structural in nature, so that we can have free, fair, and balanced trade, not just with China, but with the rest of the world. And we are looking forward to that day, but that is not this day.
I've never been a big fan of Peter Navarro. So the president himself kind of goes along with it. And I think the president's got to wake up and realize that's not the way to go.
Now, there's a lot of people, Steve, who say this is just shaky ground here. They don't know, as Jonah said, how it's going. There's others who say that this needs to be shaken up in the world order of things.
Yeah, and I'm one of them. I think Orrin Hatch is the one that needs to wake up. Look, he and the other members of the consensus that's been building around China for, you know, ever since the late 90s, that we need to engage with them and be open and all the rest of it, and that will improve their behavior. They've just been proved to be completely wrong. Ever since we've been engaging economically with China, their behavior has got more and more authoritarian. They have set out clearly a plan for world domination. That's the language they use, economically, militarily. They have a plan to beat us. We need a plan to beat them. I think it's great that we're finally standing up to them, but frankly, I don't think these measures go far enough. I would say we need a complete economic boycott of China. That is the only way to face down this threat, because if the world is run according to the values of the authoritarian communist dictatorship led by President for Life Xi Jinping, that is not a world that we want.
Steve, what happens to all of the companies that do business with China? All the workers who who would feel it on the back end?
I've heard this argument. So I made this argument when I was working in 10 Downing Street. I'm very familiar with it. There is a whole world of opportunity beyond China. There is Africa, South America, India, the greatest democracy. That's where we should be putting our priority. The suck up to China that's been going on for so long has been a complete disaster. We need to reverse it.
All right, AB, how does this play politically? Obviously, it is strange bedfellows here. You have some Democrats applauding all of these moves, including Senator Schumer.
Right. You have Democrats also like Sherrod Brown in Ohio, who is up with a 14-point lead, owning the tariffs, saying he's, you know, he's been in the Bernie Sanders wing on the far left, in unison with Trump on this for a long time. But you have other Republicans in states with farmers. I read yesterday that the hit to soybean farmers in Iowa alone will exceed $600 million. All the planning has to happen now. So whether or not we can determine, or the market can determine, or the poor Republicans Republican congressman running for re-election can determine what Trump is really going to finally do. All of the planning is taking place now. Disruption is already underway domestically and internationally. Flows through ports, people planning for their inventory, prices, supplies, all of that is rippling out. And the poor members of Congress who think that they're going to get an answer from President Trump on whether it's just a tactic or it's definitely a trade war that's going to be easy to win are going to just be sitting around waiting to see the market response and the voter response. Right. And it's really scaring them. They won't bring it up with him. But as you know, because you're up there today, Brett, it's all the talk behind
closed
doors.
Well, he brought it up first. That's what he started with in this meeting, apparently. Very quickly, Jonah, tangentially, you have China working on the North Korea issue, whether they're helping or not, and that factors in as well.
It does, and that's one of the questions that we just don't know. I mean, it is in China's interest and North Korea's interest to run out the clock as long as possible on these negotiations, which I think is what China wants to do. I think that North Korea is still essentially an unruly vassal state of China, and how you negotiate this trade war stuff while at the same time figuring out how you keep North Korea on the path to this alleged denuclearization seems to me it's very tricky. I can't quite parse it.
Panel, thank you very much for rolling with the punches tonight.